Hello.
How's your day going, Mark?
Good. Just busy trying to catch up on grades, and I teach at two other schools. I have like five classes total. So it is just like on Sunday, it's like I get slammed with hundreds of things to do. So,
Well, it's what you signed up for. What can I say?
exactly. Yeah.
And then some of us are retired and we don't have to deal with any of this.
Yeah. How's your day going?
Oh, so far so good.
Okay,
Actually
good.
learned how to crop some photos on the on my phone.
Okay, yeah.
So that was an accomplishment.
Sure. The one thing that they, when I first started, they were kind of, I guess the way that the other teacher did it was, you just email your images. I don't, and then I guess you're kind of like all online together painting. And so there was definitely that hurdle of trying to like, I mean, we're all kind of going through it still right now, where you're just trying to figure out how Canvas works and how this thing works. And so hopefully it's going okay for everyone. That's.
Yeah, well, it was interesting. I tried using or uploading the photo, the first photo of the monochromatic drawing on the computer. Would not work at all. So I downloaded the app to my phone.
Sure.
And then use the computer to find out where I needed to be because the print is too small on the phone. And then
Yeah.
I was able to upload it.
Okay. Yeah,
So
there's.
it's just kind of a roundabout way.
Yeah.
And it just gets frustrating sometimes, that's all.
I definitely appreciate everyone's sort of ability to kind of jump through all the hoops that I've set up. Yeah. But I do think that Canvas is, I think it's beneficial, especially like as we move forward. And you'll have access to all the material for like I guess a whole school year, so which is nice because I feel like there's a lot of good stuff on there. So let's see here. My. So we'll get started here in just a minute. Let me kind of rearrange a few windows. Okay. Okay. Few more people are gonna come in, so I'll just wait a second. Okay, welcome everyone. Hello. This is hope everyone's having a had a great weekend. It was a nice long weekend. Unless you're like Mary Jo was saying, if you're retired, then every day's a
Every day,
Saturday.
it's a long weekend.
Yeah. Which I'm jealous of. But we're here today, we're gonna paint, and that's a lot of fun too. This week, we don't have a new assignment. Instead, there's a lot of like information available on the module that I'll be going over and doing a demo of, a fairly quick demo. And then that way we can transition over to the painting and see how far, if we can complete this painting or at least get close. Excuse me. I don't know why. I was fine until like I turned Zoom on and now I'm like super stuffed up right now. So I will try to power through that.
Can you stop breathing in the paint then?
Yeah. Okay, so let me go through this material on the module. I'm not going to go through it like verbatim. I figure it's there for you to read anyway. But I just want to go over the basics of it. So this week, I talk a little bit about managing images and using source imagery in your painting and how you might go about doing that. And just some techniques and some overall basics of all of this. But before we jump into that, I talked a little bit about Gestalt, and I think I did, with the triangle and the circle. Yeah, okay. And so I talk a little, there's a little bit of a video here and the implications of space, and you can watch those videos. And then I talk about positive and negative space. And this is a fairly common term or terms when it comes to an art class. If you're doing a photography class or a design class or drawing, this will come up. And there's an idea between positive space and negative space. And I feel like this video is really well, I mean, I did it. So I think it's well done. I think it's very clear in terms of what it is and what I'm talking about. But the short version is, if you have like a subject matter, and we can kind of make out, you know, the image in this video here. I have a stool. The stool is the positive space. Everything else is negative space. And so that means that like the wall, the floor, the shadows that it's casting, all of this around the chair is negative space, but also the area in between. So like we could see the wall behind it, or we could see the molding also. That's all negative space. It's not the chair. So positive space is the object. Negative space is everything that isn't the object. And we can kind of shift back and forth between multiple objects. So if we have, say, two people together, one person could be the subject or the positive space, and everything else, including the other person, would be negative space. Or we can focus on the other person, or we can focus on both people simultaneously. And so we get this ability to kind of navigate between positive and negative space, like, and shifting the positive space. And the reason that's important is when we're dealing with the still life, we're looking at, say, the distance or the placement between objects. And so that negative space is measurable, just like everything else. You know, when we're measuring with the pencil and we're looking at angles and proportions, we could do the same thing for the negative space. And so this just helps us be more aware of the entirety of an image, not just the subject. And that's, you know, when we're making images, it's easy to focus in on the thing we want to focus in on and sort of lose sight on, say, the background. But as art makers, as painters, as draftspeople, we want to make sure that we're kind of presenting everything that needs to be present in an image. And so this is the next page here. And so in this one, I talk a little bit about image deconstruction. And what image deconstruction is, is basically simplifying out an image into shapes of value or color. And we've already done this, that understanding the image assignment from, I think, week one is an image deconstruction. And so understanding how an image is put together, the best way to kind of do that is to take the image apart. And so there's a good video here on how an image gets deconstructed, or how we would sort of mentally do that. And you can just see in the example here that we've got this, you know, photograph, and then we have just this very sort of vector looking image version of it. Like, it's very sort of simplified. But this is kind of the beginning step. You know, this is the start of all of it. We can get in there and get more nuance. And we see this type of imagery where the image is maybe simplified and kind of put together in a lot of different, like, things. Like, there's a lot of examples. This is Shepard Fairey, who's, like, famously known for his Obey clothing line, and then also the Obama Hope poster. And so here's an example of that. This is these are the Beatles by Kurosawa. And this is a fairly recent thing. And then we also have Andy Warhol, who did tons of things like this, where he's doing basically what's called color separation with a screen printing process. And he's printing it, and there's a little bit of offset, so it's not perfectly lined up. But he's using basically the technique that is used to print shirts and posters in his art. But that process of separating the screens and creating these multiple paths for the colors to be printed with is image deconstruction. So we can see that there. In this video, in this page, I talk a little bit about how to make a basic grid, because the next thing that we're going to talk about is the grid transfer and using that technique to transfer an image over to, say, your canvas or your watercolor paper. It's a really easy, although maybe sort of labor intensive, but very easy in concept, way to get accurate results from, say, a source image, like a printed photo, over to your canvas. Rather than just, say, eyeballing it, this will give you really, really accurate results. I go over, this first video is how to use a ruler, and I know that sounds obnoxious, but it isn't. Like, it's important to know how a ruler works, and I'm going to go through that as well. I'm going to stop that video there. Okay. And then making the grid. So that way, when we use a grid, we want sort of consistency. And so I talk about how to do the grid properly here, and I will do a demo on all that. And then there's an actual, this is my studio mate, who's also another professor at some of the other schools that I teach at. This is Chet Glaze, and he's doing the demo where he transfers the image from the source, that's this thing here, over to the paper. And then on this, I talk about some alternative ways to transfer images. And there's some historical precedents to this. A lot of times when you start an art class, you know, we're really stressing developing your skills of observation and translating what it is that you're seeing over to the page. So that's why we stress how to measure with the pencil and how to check your angles, check your proportions. And that's a really important skill, but there's easier ways to transfer images. The grid method is pretty straightforward. Anyone can do it, but there's even easier ways than that. There's a device called the camera obscura, and it's basically a pinhole camera. And it's been around for years and years and years, well before the actual photographic process. So taking a photo, like developing it on, say, a silver print or on paper, which we do now, or we don't even print it now, which was around 1880. The camera obscura has existed since, you know, it's been talked about since 500 BC. So this idea of image transfer and the phenomena of what a camera does, which is take light and passes it through a lens or an opening and then projects it onto another surface, has been around for a long time. And we can see this is the basic model here. So what it does is you have a light source out here and objects that are well lit. And then this would be the camera obscura. It could be a room, it could be small, it could be really large, it just sort of depends. And it's basically what we would call a pinhole camera. And so there's a small hole, and all of that light condenses into this hole, and this room is completely dark except for that little hole there. All that light passes through, and on the opposite wall, the image is projected upside down. It just flips because it like passes through. And so artists would use this technique to transfer images. So they'd have their models pose out here, and it would be well lit, and then they'd be in this little room, and then they would put their canvas on this surface or sometimes paper, and they would have them pose and go into the dark room and trace it out. And it's by no means like diminishing anyone's skill. They are, you know, artists are all well trained. You know, it's sort of a process, and you practice and you get better. This just expedites the process, you know. So sometimes you end up with this argument that it's like cheating, that it's sort of like gaming the system, but it really isn't. There's a really good book that David Hockney made, who's also an artist, where he discusses the use of the camera obscura in Renaissance paintings. And this is a short little video on that. Along with that is this idea of cartooning. And cartooning is another technique sort of used around the same time, where they would take paper and make these elaborate drawings and then go through and poke holes along the, say, contours or edges of the image. And then they would put that onto, say, the canvas or the panel or the wall, and then pounce it with charcoal dust. And it would go through the pinholes and create basically a connect the dot of whatever the drawing is. And so that was an easy way to kind of transfer an image over from, say, a drawing to your canvas or wall surface. So if they had the camera obscura here and they were painting on like a mural on a wall, obviously they can't put the wall in that place, but they could do that on paper and then bring the paper to the wall and then get the transfer. So it's sometimes a multi-step process. A lot of artists still use these tools. There's also something called a camera lucida, which is using lenses to kind of like see two images at once where they overlap. But more recently, we have much better technology. And what we have are things like an opaque projector, and that's basically just light. So there's a light source in here, and you put it on top of the image, so you can see the image here. and it lights up the image, and then the image bounces off of a mirror on the inside, and it goes through a lens so you can focus it, and then that will project onto whatever surface you have in front of the lens. This, I mean, it has some limitations, but it works pretty well. This is like a school, like a grade school kind of device you might have seen. But even more so than that are these overhead projectors. These are like gold. If you can get them still, they're fantastic. They're just the standard overhead projector, like from grade school or college or whatever. And you have a transparency sheet, and you could either print your image onto the transparency sheet and then project it through here. There's a light source, and then you have the focus and lens here. There's a mirror in there. So it goes up through here, bounces off the mirror and out this big old lens here and onto your surface. And you can scale things up and scale things down depending on how close it is, makes it smaller. The further away it is from the canvas, it makes it bigger. And you can get really accurate images. You could also just take a clear sheet, just like in school, you know, if they're doing math problems, they used to just write on these like clear transparency film. And you can just get those still and then just draw with a Sharpie. You just lay the clear sheet on top of your image and trace it out. And then bring that transparency over here and project it. That's not giving you as much detail, but it gets you right in there. It gets you like moving right along. Gets your proportions correct, gets your sort of composition correct, your positive and negative space correct. I still have a few of these kind of left over. They're sort of like treasures to me. But instead, now I have a digital projector. And so these are just like, you know, from Amazon. This one I don't have this exact one, but I have like a cheap $60 one. And then I also have this like fancy one that's about the size of a soda can. And I can project my image straight from my phone onto the thing. I just plug my phone in. So I take a picture of something and I can project it onto a canvas and trace it out really quick. And then I'm off to painting, which is...
Mark, kindly, yes. Spilla.
Yes.
I had a question. I have one of those projectors, which I always struggled with because I didn't have any surface high enough to project it onto the wall to make sure. It the size I wanted. I'm just wondering with this new light box that you just showed with the your cell phone, how big of an image can you actually make of that? I mean, can you go big or is it going to be small still?
So one of these here, is that what you're asking?
The
or this one up here?
No, not the not that one. That's way, that's okay. Grammar school. No, these two, the Pepsi and the iPhone thing.
Okay, yeah. So to make it bigger, you just bring it back further.
So you can make those bigger and they'll still be pretty high resolution, or are they gonna be real fun?
You know, the cheap one is pretty low res. You'll get a lot of like pixelation. This one is much higher res. I think it is 1080. So it's pretty sharp. And this was only, you know, 100, maybe $200. They have an even higher one, which I think is 2K or something. And that one is like $400 or $500.
Wow.
And then you know, but you get no pixelation and it can project up to like 100 inches diagonal. Wow. So that's like a, you know, how they measure TV screens. Okay.
You find these on Cheap Joe's or Amazon or
Amazon. And you know, if you wait for like Black Friday sale or this thing or that thing, they end up being pretty inexpensive.
Okay, thanks.
And actually a lot of the work that I do for the class, just for sort of to expedite the process, like I started off showing you that I could actually draw things,
right?
But, you know, we don't have to sit here and watch me draw. So rather than do that, and we could just focus on the painting, I'll just project it onto the paper. So I can actually scale it down to 11 by 15 or scale it all the way up to say, like, I'm doing a painting right now and it is, let's say, about 7 feet by 12 feet.
Wow.
And I can go even bigger than that. So, wow. Yeah. Okay. So there's a lot of like usefulness with these tools, and it just helps kind of jumpstart that process and gets you to the actual painting rather than struggling with like the grid transfer or drawing it by, say, eyeballing it. But yeah, I love these digital projectors. And then you were saying that you were having a problem like putting it on a surface high enough. So generally there's a thread on the bottom, and you can mount it to a tripod. So you can, you know, and the tripod, depending on like the style of tripod you have, you can have it like really low to the ground, or you can raise it up to about like 5 feet. So you can adjust that and really fine tune where it's projecting from. So. And then there is a video down here on how the projector works. And this is sort of universally about like, it sort of applies to everything. So all the way from the camera obscura to the digital projectors and everything in between. But between that video, I also talk a little bit about a light box. And a light box is just a translucent kind of sheet of glass or plex, like plastic, and it's lit from the bottom, and you can kind of see here that the image is showing through the paper. So with a strong light source, you can actually see through the image through the paper and trace it out. But the problem with that is you're limited to one-to-one. You can't make it bigger, you can't make it smaller. Whatever the print size is what you're stuck with. And this is actually used a lot for animation. There's light boxes, and sometimes they'll have like pegs so that all the paper lines up together, and then they'll like flip through and then trace it. So that way, you know, there's not like a big jump from, say, one scene to another. So light boxes are still pretty handy. You can also kind of like fake a light box if you just tape your image up to a window and tape your paper up to it, and then you could just on a sunny day just trace right through it. This is just another version of the understanding the image assignment. It's really just an exercise, but instead of being in black and white, when we're focused on value, we're looking at all of the different colors. So where we might have seen similarities between, say, this area and this area, now all of a sudden we can see some separation because there's a difference in saturation level, right? So if you think back to the previous one, you know, we were very, I had the solution there, and you could be very detailed, but with the addition of color information, all of a sudden it changes what we're seeing. And the main implication there is that color is adding even more. So the hue and saturation levels, along with the value, is adding even more information. And that's more related to kind of the color discussion that we had from 2 weeks ago. Or was it a week ago? And this is just the full size image. If you want to try it, it's available to you. And you can kind of like really see all of the different colors here. So like this shadow area here in the black and white version, it might have been just one color or one shape. But now with the addition of color, we've got blue here. We've got sort of this muddier, sort of desaturated version. We have a darker version here. We've got a lighter version here. So we're getting a lot more information. And that's really kind of the point of that. And then I have a short little thing here on just introducing you to contemporary artists. And when we talk about art, you know, there's different movements of art. We'll talk a little bit about history later on. But when we talk about artists that are working currently, and that's from, say, the 90s up to now, this is a period that we would call contemporary art. So even though they're like modern, we don't say modern. They're not modern artists, because modern art is its own genre of art. And that's like a historical genre now at this point. Modern art is, say, from like the 1900s up through 1950, 1960-ish. And that's like the time period of modern art that we would sort of consider modern art. Everything after that is like pop art and then into contemporary art. And so Claire Tabaret is a contemporary artist. She works now. She lives in Los Angeles and France, and she makes these amazing paintings. She's got like a great sense of color, and there's a lot of fun videos here of her painting that you can watch and just see more of her work. These are great too. Really gigantic paintings. And then this is just a last semester's version of this discussion, but I'll post this Zoom right above it. We'll stop that here. Any questions on that? No? All right, so what I do want to discuss is the grid transfer, just so that way I kind of talk a little bit about it, and then we're going to take a break after that and then get to painting. So let me switch this to my other screen, my other camera. All right, so that's what we'll be painting later on, but for now, let me get an image here. This one, and something else. Okay. Now I'm not going to do the full, and let me kind of turn my screen so my talking head is still there. Right there. Cool. I'm not going to do the full thing, but I just want to discuss some of the finer points of this. Don't need that yet. Oh yeah, I do actually. All right, so this is Paul Newman. He's on a fishing boat and having a good time. And this is printed out on an 8.5 by 11 kind of standard sheet. I print it as big as I can because it sort of allows me that ability to kind of measure things out. So I got my thing here. The image size itself is about 10.5 inches by 8.25 inch, right? That's the full image size. The full paper size is 8.5 by 11. I'm going to transfer that over to, say, an 11 by 14 piece of paper. So there'd really just be a little bit of math involved. And I didn't actually do the math here. But if you have, say, an 8.5 by 11, And you want to put that onto, you see that all right? And you want to put that onto, say, an 11 by 14. You're going to end up with a little bit of like remainder, and you might have to trim it off. But basically, you just figure out how much, like this either goes into the short dimension, so 8.5 divided by 11, or it's this here divided by that, 11 divided by 14. And that's going to equal, let me just get my calculator really quick. And the reason that we do this is I'll show you why in a second. I'm just going to. So this gives me about 0.77 dot, dot, dot. And then this is 11 divided by 14. And this gives me 0.78 dot, dot, dot. And that basically is really close to 3/4, right? So what I could do is, so this is approximately 3/4. What I could do is grid this paper out to 3/4 of an inch, and then grid this paper out to 1 inch. Does that make sense? No? A little bit? Not really? Okay. Well, basically it's like this. We're trying to expand this image here to this size here, right? Doing the math right here, what that's telling us is that this current image is about 75% of this total size. So you can kind of work this in a lot of different ways. You can sort of go from this to this or this to this, but basically I need the same amount of squares across and the same amount of squares up and down here as I have over here, right? And so if I grid this big piece of paper out at 1 inch, then I would grid this one out at 0.75 inches, 3/4 of an inch. And so that's kind of the process of like being able to expand this. A more simple thing is if this is 8.5 by 11 and I wanted to double it, right? Make this twice as big, it would turn into 17 by 22 inches. So if I had a 17 by 22 inch piece of paper, or say like an 18 by 24, that's a standard size, I could measure this out and grid this at 1 inch. And then on the bigger paper, grid it out because I'm doubling it at 2 inches, right? So there's a ratio happening. And that's all it really is. So the math wasn't here to confuse you or scare you off from doing this, but that's what I'm gonna do here. So I'll start off with this one, and I'm not gonna grid the whole thing, but I just have this floor right now. It's kind of hard to see. Sort of obnoxious. Let me see if I have my other ruler. Somewhere. Okay. So now, I'm just talking about the whole piece of paper. There's a little bit of a border. I'm just going to include that. So what I do is I line this up on the zero, right? And then I make a mark every 3/4 of an inch. And actually, let me zoom in on this screen right now. 1 second. All right. Okay. I'm going to use a darker pencil just so it's easier to see. You might do this with, say, a pen. That sometimes helps, especially if it's like on a print like this. I don't want to go too dark. Okay, there we go. All right, so I'm gonna line this up, make sure that my ruler goes straight across. I could do it here at the very bottom, but I like to place my ruler actually onto the image, and I line the bottom up. You can kind of see a small reveal there. Now I'm gonna measure and mark every 3/4 of an inch. So there's 3/4, the next one would be 1.5 inches, and then 2.25, 3 inches, so on and so forth, all the way down, right? And so I've got little marks here. Where did they go? Over here. So I've got one here, and then one here in the, sort of hard to see. And rather than just trying to set a straight line that goes up and down here, what that does is sometimes I'll end up with with the line being wider up here or shorter or closer together. I want to connect the dots. So I'm going to bring my ruler, I'm keeping the image oriented the same way, and I'm just bringing my ruler up to the top. And I'm going to zero out my ruler here. And I'm going to measure every 3/4 of an inch. Like so. And now all I do is connect the dots. So I've got a dot there. And where's my other one? Sorry, it's like hard to see. There. All right. A little bit off. So I like to touch the dot. There you go. And I'm just going to do this all the way. So I touch the dot, line up my ruler. And the reason that I flip my ruler over is because this has a cork bottom. And so when it's upside down and it's resting on the cork bottom, I can actually kind of dig my pencil underneath it, and that won't give me an accurate result. If I flip my ruler over like this, now I'm not measuring anything, I'm just drawing a straight line. The surface, the metal edge is resting right where I want it to. So I can kind of go and draw a straight line. That's just something that I do. You don't have to do that. All right, so now I have lines, and I would continue that all the way. I would turn this 90 degrees and do the same process and measure out every 3/4 of an inch. So I can zero it out here. I'm just gonna rest on that line. Measure 3/4, 3/4, 3/4. And I would do the same towards the bottom. It's not hard for me to see, so I'm just gonna do it here on the edge, 3/4. And then connect those dots. Yeah. So now you can see that it's the beginning of having this image completely gridded out, right? Then I would go over to my paper. Here's my paper. And I would measure this one out at 1 inch. So again, this was about 75% and this is 100%. So 3/4 of an inch, 1 whole inch. And you just go through and basically grid all the way down. So just like so. Measure but out up at the top. Now, one of the reasons that you do this, you measure up at the top and you don't flip your paper, is because sometimes the paper isn't cut perfectly. Now, it says that it's 14 inches, but it could be, say, 13 7/8 of an inch. And if you were to say, start measuring down here, that's an inch over here, and it's only like 13 7/8, and you flip this and you start measuring over here, they're not going to line up straight up and down, right? So you need to kind of maintain the same direction. So if I'm measuring from, say, side A, and this is side B, this is C, and this is D, I'm measuring in this direction. So I'm going to measure here at the bottom, measure here at the top, and that's going to give me straight lines. Go through, complete this grid. So, and then you'd go all the way and then turn it horizontal, and then you could do the same thing. So I'm going to measure down here every inch. Dot, 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 so on and so forth. And then measure here at the top every inch. Connect those dots. Can't really see it just yet, but I'm going to zoom out here in a second. When you do the grid, you want to draw your grid as light as possible. I'm drawing it really dark so that way you all can see it, but you'd eventually want to erase the grid. So it's not like you want it as heavy and as dark as I have here. All right, so let me zoom out a little bit. There we go. So now comes the fun part. If it's not fun already. You go basically square to square, and this square, I would end up with, say, the same amount, hopefully, or close to. So this one I'd end up with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 14 squares across. And this one, I think I would end up with 4, 8, 12. Looks like almost 13 squares. So I'm pretty close. I'm right where I need to be. So now all I do is whatever happens in this square, I transfer to this square. Whatever happens in this square, I transfer to this square, right? In this square here, I guess I have the margin. So I'll draw that in like that. And then this square here, I have the continuation of that margin. But then I have the edge of that boat, and it kind of hit, if this is about halfway of the square, it hits right above halfway. And it starts right at the margin. So here's half. It's above halfway, kind of like that. And I could either continue that information or just kind of work my way up. I'll just work my way up. So I've got that margin again. And I have this fishing pole, and that sits just above halfway again. And it's pretty thin. So it starts here, ends there. Starts here, ends about there. And it's, say, about that thick. And it has a stripe, and then it has the little eye for the pole. It's a little P shape like that, And also I'm getting a little bit of information with the wave. So there's like a dark path there and a dark path there. There's just like a little dark shape there and a dark shape there. This next square is just the margin plus some ocean stuff. There's like a little dark area here. It's kind of small detail, so I'm going to leave that. I'm going to work my way over here. So on this square, I've got the continuation of that margin. I've got the edge of the boat, and it stops here and starts there. So starts here and stops about here, like that. The stripe kind of goes, this is about halfway. So maybe a quarter of the way down, but it just follows that same sort of direction, like that. We'll do this square now. You know, obviously the boat kind of continues, so I could just use that same point, just kind of commit to that. Same thing with this one. I get a little bit of that corner, like right there in the corner, and I get the pull of the awning. And so that is maybe right around here. Like that. Might have to be a little higher. I could make that adjustment. And then the pole itself is right around there. Right. Moving up, I've got the continuation of the fishing pole. That. The continuation of the awning pole, like that. And that awning pole kind of disappears right behind that fishing pole. So it's like right there. And then the edge of the hull. And it kind of comes up like that too. I've got a little bit of this like dark shape as it comes across here. I've got a little bit of a wave here, or maybe that's the fishing line I'm seeing. But there's just like a little light ridge there and a little bit of lightness there, a little bit of darkness there. Moving on, the next square is this one. There's a lot of ocean stuff still. So there's like the end of that piece right there. And this looks like a bungee cord or something. I'm going like that. And then maybe a little bit of some stuff in the wave, some value changes there. And essentially what I'm going to end up with is this entire image transferred over here, and it's going to look like paint by numbers. And then it's just a matter of painting it. But this gives me, you can kind of see the comparison here. I've been able to expand this up by about 25%. And I'm getting a pretty accurate result, you know, in this section here. I guess it would have been more impressive to do like his face, but really it doesn't matter what you're drawing. Everything you draw is just a shape, right? As long as you're putting the correct shape in the right place, it's going to look like what it's supposed to look like. And that doesn't matter if it's the boat, the ocean, the fishing pole, a hand, a face, you know, someone's shorts, whatever. All we're really doing is just copying shapes. And so this allows us a really accurate way of copying. We're just simplifying and just focusing on one square at a time and copying what shapes we see over from here to here. And that's the basics of the grid technique. And you can use this kind of infinitely, right? If I grid this out and I make, and let's say it's like 13 squares by, that's four, 8 by 10 squares, 13 by 10. If I were to make squares as big as, say, like 4 feet wide, if I had 13 squares in a row by 10 squares high, I could make this thing gigantic. You know, I'm just doing the same process. I'm focusing on one square at a time and just breaking it down and simplifying it. Or I could even shrink it. So if I grid this at, say, 3/4, and I want to make it like 1/4 of an inch, I mean, that's crazy to draw that many squares, but you know, you can cut it in half. You can go big, you can go little, and this allows you the ability to change dimensions. And as long as you have a ruler, you know, it's fair game, like sky's the limit. Any questions on this?
I hate the grid method. I find that it just kills creativity, and it's too left brain for me.
I hate it too. but it's like, you know, in the event of like societal collapse and you wanted to transfer an image over and we couldn't plug in our projectors, you know, this is it still exists. It's a way to kind of like transfer an image. Really,
I accurately. Do the point to point. That's what I do. 3-point, you know, that's how I enlarge.
I mean, there's a lot of methods, you know, and as you develop your skill, you could be able to just eyeball it, and that's fine too. But if you're really struggling with maybe accuracy, it's hard to sort of beat this technique. Yeah, Ryan.
Yeah, we're gonna learn techniques on freehanding.
That's more of like a drawing class. I feel like, you know, the main thing, and actually here's something, when I teach a drawing class, this idea of sighting something, using your pencil to check the angles and check the proportions, that's all I really teach.
Yeah.
Like from the very beginning, I give you all the keys right at the beginning, and it's just developing the correct habits based on those skills. Mm-hmm. When I draw something, I'm still doing this and still citing things, and that's all I'm doing. And it's just refining that practice and getting better and more comfortable with it. So while we're not going to be focusing on it, basically the thing that I showed you at the very beginning of the semester is the thing that you would just continue to do if you were in a drawing class with me. I might introduce like new tools, new mediums to use, but at the end of the day, it's this. It's still just this. yeah. Cool. I really do not like the grid. It's so tedious. It is so time consuming. It's really labor intensive. And that's why the projector just speeds everything up so much faster. Like, you know, it's not any less of a skill. It's not like, you know, it's doing the work for me. I'm still doing a lot of interpretation the way that I would do if I'm doing the grid technique, the way that I would do if I was sighting it and just observing it and like eyeballing it. And really, it's just about getting to the point where we get to painting. So on that note, we'll get to painting, but we'll take a quick break first. So we'll do like 10 minutes and we'll come back and work on this painting that's behind me right now. Okay. All right. So 10 minutes. Yes. Mark.
Okay. So I'm going to be probably going to take my computer and get it worked on, but I came in a little late if you took the roll.
I don't really take roll, so
what time does the class end?
11:50, or no, I'm sorry, 2:50.
I think I have to leave earlier. I have another appointment.
That's fine. The video will be available, so you can watch it in its entirety. So everything that you miss and everything that you will miss, you can watch.
Thank you.
Sure. All right. So I'm gonna take a break. Okay. So just so you have it again, I know that it's on Canvas and I sent it before, but I just sent out the image that I'm working from.
Mark, so yeah. I found a GridMaker app, but it like it takes your picture and it completely distorts it. So I don't know how to fix that.
Ah, that's weird.
Like it took all the pieces and made it into grids, which is great, and that's what I wanted it to do, but like it changed it all around and I have no idea where it goes.
that looks like the game where you slide it back.
I know, right?
Yeah. Yeah. There are a lot of like websites that'll overlay a grid if you count like tell it how many squares you want, and that's a really easy way. I totally forgot to mention that. But yeah, that's a great, great thing. And then you could even, I mean, you don't have to print it out. You could just work from your phone, but you could also have it printed out with the grid directly on it once you do that.
What website would do that?
If you just Google like grid overlay photo, it'll come up. There's like a dozen of them that'll come up, and then you just put your photo on, or like you load your photo up to it, and then there's even like a sometimes there's like a drop down menu of like how many squares across you want, and it's pretty straightforward. So if you know how many squares you have on say your canvas or your paper, you know, if you're working on 11 by 15, I would grid it at 1 inch, and then you upload your photo, you just say I need 11 squares by 15 squares, and it does the math for you. So yeah. So yeah, I'm gonna jump into this painting. This one, and I'm gonna zoom in just a little bit. There you go. So I didn't touch it. That's kind of where we left off. I think that there's a lot I have to do still. Yeah. Okay, so feel free to, you know, chat with each other, talk to me, whatever. I'll be doing my best to kind of walk and chew gum at the same time. I'll be like painting and narrating what I'm doing as best as I can. But sometimes I get in like a moment where I'm just sitting and painting. And okay. So right now I'm thinking of, I mean, this frog is a little bit on the light side, but I kind of like the colorfulness of it. It's not as brown as what I have, but I do think that this is sort of weirdly too light. Because when I squint at the image, it's a bit darker. So I just want to.
I thought it was a brass frog.
Yeah, it's made of wood. Yeah. I mean, it's kind of close in color. So I'm just going to pick up a little bit of that brown. That's actually got some red stuck on it from last time. And that might work okay. There's a little bit of that brown. And I'm just going to pick up some of that yellow that was over here. Yeah. And I don't want to go too dark. I just want to kind of color this up a little bit, so it doesn't look as too different. And I'm going to take that same color and just introduce it in a few other spots here and there. And that's just going to help add a little bit of continuity to the overall object, right? So if it's giving me a little bit of like similarity from this to this. Maybe a little bit like right here.
I got booted out somehow, but I'm back.
Okay, welcome back. And then I'm just gonna use that same color right here because that eye is a little, I mean, it's too white. So I just wanna, you know, add a bit of that color to it. All right. And let me just add just some of that roundness to that. I'm just mimicking maybe some of the directionality. Yeah, that feels pretty good. I'm gonna take that same color because this is in the same family. I'm just gonna do some thinner, more linear strokes here. Maybe start it, stop it, pick it back up. And again, that's tying everything together a little bit more. There you go. Cool. So I'm pretty happy with that frog. I'm going to move on to... I don't know. I'm going to move on to the shadows here. Yeah. Okay. So on my palette, it's sort of off screen here. Let me see if I can bring it in. I still have some of this blue and I'm just going to loosen that up and add some water to that. And I want to dull it out a bit. I don't want it like so intense. So I'm going to use the complementary color. And for me, that's going to be orange. So I'm going to pick up a little bit of orange and just add it. It's kind of purplish, but that's fine. So then maybe I pick up a little bit of yellow here. I still want to keep it in the blue family. So I'm just adding, I'm sorry, you can't see that. I'm adding just a touch of blue, keeping it cool, but neutralizing that color. These shadows aren't too dark. So I'm just going to start off a little bit lighter. And I want to come in here and I want to use sort of the ridges to help sell the idea that the paper is folded. So as I get out here to the edge, I just want to be kind of more specific with the overall shape. It's a little bit lighter on the floor surface. So I'll kind of go here, like this dark here, and then maybe as my brush runs out, I can use whatever residual paint is on there to do that ground area. Down here, it's just got that shadow there. It's pretty light over here, but I can just go for it and just do the whole thing. And I'm just going to make that shadow and this shadow even darker. So I'm just going to come in and again, using sort of those ridges to help sell the idea of the fold of that fan. A little bit light. Go maybe just a touch darker. And it's kind of warm in my house. So I'm just going to take some of that paint off the brush, touch this up just a little bit, and have the water that's on my brush. So you can see I just kind of mixed out here. That's a lot lighter. So I feel like I can come in here and start painting this as well. So yeah, it's a little bit lighter, which is what I want. And I can come in and just move that little bit of paint around. through here. So that way we get that kind of continuation and change in direction. And if it pulls up like this, I can wipe my brush off and just sort of like lift a bit of that paint up. Yeah, just like that. And I'll just come in and use what's on my brush to push. So I'm gonna use that same sort of light blue gray. And I'm going to pick up this shadow on the frog here. There's that weird, like, lighter shadow. And so I'm just going to pick up the few little, just some indications of it here and there. Maybe I want to go a bit darker for the ones that are out this way. Now, I'm not doing the darkest shadows just yet. I'm just doing these, like, overlapping ones. And just like with a frog, where I use that same color a little bit here and a little bit over there, this is doing the same thing. So I'm sort of tying all of these shadows together, even though maybe this has a little bit more of a green cast. I'm just going to go ahead and put that in. I'm going to make that one a bit more green when it goes darker, just because it's got that transparency. But this is what's coming out pretty good here. So I want to be a little bit careful here. It's going to be that dark shadow that's going to help redefine that edge. I'm just going to let this sort of fade out right there. I'm going to do a little bit around the octopus. I'm just going to find it. Where is it? So it's like right there. Maybe this one here and this one there. I'm going to take some of that paint off. There you go. I'm not going to be too fussy about it. I'm just kind of blocking it in, be a little bit loose with my brush. Does this guy have a shadow? He doesn't really have a shadow that he's casting for some reason. It's hidden by the frog. But maybe I come in just because I feel like it's missing it. So I'm just going to give it just a little bit right there. Yeah, okay. It's pretty good. So the next thing, once this sets up a little bit more, I'm going to come in and I'm going to do these darker shadows here. Now, because the surface that I shot on is white and the light is pretty even, like in terms of color, it's not warm or cool. It sort of made this really a grayish shadow. So this and this are really in that gray family, but I kind of want to keep some color in there. I don't want to just mix out with some black. I'm avoiding using black. So to make it darker, I'm just going to, up in my palette over here, I'm just going to get a little bit of water. I'm going to loosen up more of that blue. Like that. Mix it with sort of that grayed out version you can see there. And now I have like a pretty dark, pretty dark thing here. You know, I just realized you could probably see it. I don't have to do all that weird twisting and turning there. Okay. So, right there, you can see it's a bit darker. So I'm just gonna come in. Again, using maybe some of those ridges to help sell that idea a bit. I got some weird, like, kind of artifacts that go out this way. Some of those shadow shapes, like, right up under that thing. And I'm going to use the same kind of dark color for the remaining shadows. So, like, over here. Some of these guys under the octopus. I think that one's one. It's another. It's like a deep shadow up through here. I'm gonna pick up just a few hints here and there on some of these other shadows just to help kind of, again, tie it all together. And I'm going to use that here on the frog. I might go darker right up in here once I sort of let this dry a bit. So it might be a second layer. Use this one here. Yeah, I think it needs like a bit more darkness in there. And this one here. So now this is going to help redefine what that shape is. I'm sort of losing some of my color. So I want to go just pick up more of this blue. So I'm using, I sort of shaped my brush so it's like fine. And I can really get in here and get some of these like sharper shapes. This is a really thin linear shape. It's, I don't really consider it like a line. I'm still thinking in terms of shape. I'm just gonna make that a bit bigger. And maybe just some small indications like inside the actual thing there. Those ridges. Does this need it? I don't know if that needs it, but so now that adds a little bit of definition. I think I'm gonna keep going, but I want to go purple. I want to go with some violet here. So I'm picking up blue, I'm picking up violet. I need a little bit more water. So I want to go really dark, and because I kind of push this into that reddish family, this is going to give me a really dark color that'll let me get up into that, those crevices there and make that darker. And I'm just going to drag it out along the edge there. And I'm going to carry that over to this side here because it's like right up in that corner. Looks a little harsh right now, but what I'm gonna do here in 1 second is I'm gonna clean my brush off. So I'm just wiping all that paint off, clean it in the water, take a little bit of that water off, and I'm just gonna break that edge up a bit. That's just gonna help kind of drag more of that paint outwards and not be as like so solid. All right. I do think I could maybe push this a little darker here, so I'll use that same thing. So I just loading up with paint again. I'm not going to do all the way across. I'm just going to maybe like pick up right up in there. Just a few little indicators that there's a shadow happening. All right. And the only other shadow I'm really missing is this one here. So I'm going to pick up some of this blue and I'm just going to mix it right here onto this green because I want it to go a bit greenish. And I'll test that. And that looks a little too dark, so I'm gonna water that down. And test that again. Maybe my brush is just too loaded. Yeah, okay, that's pretty good. So I just thinned it out using some water. And I'm just gonna come in and pick up this one here. Oh, that's not enough paint. So a little bit more paint, a little less water. Let's kind of clean that one little dark area up. And what's that? Cool. I do feel like I can go more intense in terms of color with that bottle. It's sitting a little bit. Sorry, I'm trying to grab something. It's sitting a little pale, so I think I want to push those colors a bit, but that would be sort of towards the end. But those shadows all of a sudden create a lot more depth and a lot more space, and that's what we want. Like all of a sudden this fan feels like it's leaning against the wall, and really those shadows were critical for that. I really only have maybe two more things to do, which is the little hammer game thing and this octopus. With the octopus, it's when something is really metallic, then you get into this territory of sort of needing black. What we see when we look at like the object are these really kind of sharp individual shapes. There's very little blending. It's like a black shape next to say a yellow shape next to a white shape next to a black shape. And let me see if I can find it and dig it out real quick. I did do a ring, you in like a gold ring, and you can maybe get a better sense of what it is that I'm about to do. If I can find it, let me find it. Lots of paintings here. All right. So it's not complete, but it's the beginning. And so here, so that's a very large painting of this ring with two ram heads on it. And what you can see, and I'm going to bring it up really close here, is that there's like individualized like black areas, yellow areas, and white areas. And I've got about, let's say, 1, 2, 3, 4 different, including white, 5 different colors kind of at play here. For the octopus, I'll be doing something similar. I'm gonna switch from this brush because it's so thin and small to my smaller brush. And I was trying to avoid using black. I could mix, say, my ultramarine plus my burnt umber. And that's going to give me something really, really dark. So maybe I'll do that. And then because I want it to be a bit warm, I'm going to have more ultramarine than, more burnt umber than ultramarine. Let me clean off an area on my palette. I'm going to spray that and wipe it away. Good. I don't need to mix a ton of paint here, but let me get some of this burnt umber. Just want to loosen it up. I want this to be pretty pure, or not, like I want it to be very saturated, so not diluted. So I'm going to really kind of agitate this little bit of water I added to it right there, just to get that paint up on it. And then I'm going to do the same for this ultramarine, so this dark blue. And I'm going to mix those two together. And you can see how dark that went. So that's kind of a great combination. And then as it, right now, it's a lot of ultramarine in there. So it's very cool in terms of how dark it is. But if I add more of this burnt umber, it'll warm that up. So as it thins out, it'll go warmer. It won't be as cool. All right. So I'm loading up my brush. I've got very little water on there. It's just enough to kind of keep it fluid. And now what I'm going to do is paint in just the black shapes, like quote unquote black shapes on there. They're very distinct and very linear. They don't blend. They have a very hard edge. So I want to kind of mimic that. I didn't draw them out here. So I just have to watch what I'm doing, kind of make my way across this. There's a lot of like fine, small shapes. I don't tend to think of them as detail per se. I think more of it as like just small shapes.
Mark?
Yes.
This is Mary Jo. What size brush are you using?
This is a 6.
6. Okay.
I've got like even smaller brushes, but I feel like this one comes up to a fine enough point that I'm comfortable with it.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. So I'm just using like the point of my brush. I'm checking what it is that I'm looking at compared to what I'm painting. A lot of little stuff happening here. It's kind of, it can get confusing. So the more that you map it out, the more that you transfer, the easier it is to like fill those shapes in rather than having to invent them kind of on the fly, like what I'm doing here. That's pretty good. I'm up to like the head of this octopus. And I think that's it. Is that it? Let's simplify that out. There's a little dot here for the eye, and then maybe just like some small dots here, just kind of create the suction cups of the tentacles. like right there. I'm not like outlining every single one. I'm just kind of giving you just this idea that there's some texture happening here. I guess this guy needs some a little bit of love over here. Some, yeah, a little bit there. A little bit there. I feel like I'm missing maybe just something right here. This, yeah, that's pretty good. All right. So now I don't want to rush this because the paint is so heavy and saturated. And it's so dark. I don't want to like let it bleed into other areas. So I want to make sure that it dries completely and it's fully set up. Maybe while I have it out, I'll do the same color for like the face here, because it's like a printed face. So, you know, while I'm here, might as well. Again, I'm not going to be too outlining with this, even though there's a lot of outline. The suggestion is usually enough. I want the level of painting to kind of match the rest of what I've done. So if I'm being kind of loose and simple at moments, then this also gets that same kind of treatment. That's good. And yeah, I don't want to use too much of this, even though it's not technically a black. It's as heavy as black would be. And if I start to put it throughout this thing, if I'm like, oh, maybe I should make that or like some of these lines here, then it starts to feel too visually separate from everything else. So I want to limit my use. So I feel like this and this, that's more than enough. And I'm going to let that set. We're waiting on that. I guess I can paint this blue stripe here. I'm just going to clean off my palette, not my paint area here, because there's just a little bit of brown mixed in that. I just want to get rid of that and just get back to the blue. All right. So I think this blue is too dark by itself and this blue is too light by itself, but I think a combination of the two is going to give me enough. Maybe a little bit more of that ultramarine. That's going to give me that blue that I want. Maybe a bit of water on there, just so it's not as heavy. And paint the stripe in. Each of these blocks is sort of rounded. I drew them a bit straight. So I'm just gonna kind of come up to the edge and let it overlap a bit. There's a value shift that's happening across this that I wanna pick up on. And I might do that through glazing. So rather than mixing out a completely different color, I'm just going to let this sit and then give it a second coat just on the darker side. I'm just evening that out. good. I'll let it sit for a second. That's pretty good. So I'm just loading up just the tip of my brush. I don't want too much water on here. I'm just gonna come in and make it darker where I think it needs to be darker. I'm getting like a bounce light from the table. So that's sort of what I'm seeing and picking up on. Maybe just like this small ridge here. That's fine. Now I'm gonna do the same thing for the red one. This red is pretty intense. I'm gonna try this. Let's see what this cad red looks like. Again, I want this to be kind of more saturated than anything else. So, you know, very little water, lots of loosening up that paint with just a little bit of water, just so I get some real intensity here. Maybe too orange. I'm gonna pick up some of this magenta here. See if I can calm that down a bit. Yeah, there you go. That's getting close. So it's not as sort of neutral as magenta is. It's not as yellow as whatever that was. Kind of more of that red family. Same thing, very little water. I'm losing the shape of my brush here, so I do need some water on there. And it'll help sort of make my brush back to the shape it needs to be. Trying to keep that pigment load up. It's pretty good. Maybe it comes up a little bit right there. Same thing, I'm gonna give it a second and then I'm gonna come in. There's a more distinct shadow on the left side of that. And rather than mixing black into it, I'm just gonna go for more saturation. Generally with transparent colors in the red and blue family, the more that you layer over it, it tends to get darker and darker. You can kind of see that happen here with this violet. You can see that it's a little lighter there, and where it overlays a bit, it got darker. That happens there. That happens with blues and reds and violets because it's made of blues and reds. It's not quite ready yet, so I gotta wait. As I'm waiting, I'm sort of looking at the rest of this painting. And, you know, the wood here is different than this wood. It's much like blonder. So I'm looking at that color and I'm trying to see if that color occurs out in here. And I think it does. I think there's some instances like right here in the head of these like kind of orangey yellow colors, like neutral or like yellow orange, that I could use here as well. So that's sort of what I'm thinking about. All right, so load and paint. Yeah, there you go. Just trying to leave that on the surface. Yeah, and I think y'all can see that there's a slight value shift from this side to this side. This feels a little clumsy, but I think I am seeing a reflected lighter area right through here in the image, but I think I can make this overall a little bit more blue. So I'm gonna clean my brush off and I'm going to pick up some of that blue paint and be kind of thin and wet with it. And I'm just gonna give it a coat, and that's just gonna bring that color up a little bit, or down, I guess. So now as I jump into kind of the remaining area of painting here, my water, because I've been mixing blues and reds in there, is now sort of this dark violet plus the black that I made. I do not want to use this water. If I'm going to work in yellow, I don't want to use this water at all. So it's important that I have some clean water here. Because what's going to happen is if I mix that with my yellows, it's going to neutralize those colors. I do want a little bit of neutral in there, but I want to control it. I don't want it to happen because I dipped into the wrong water. Let's see. I'm just gonna clean this off a bit. I'll just use my spray bottle and wipe this away. Going back to my big brush here. I'm just going to move my water over a little bit. Now this yellow is not the same as this yellow here. It's more muted. So I will need to pick up some violet, but I already have like things happening on my palette that I can pull from. I know I wiped off a lot of blue and red, but I don't need much. So I'll just loosen that up. Just more of that yellow. And now I'm going to loosen some of that violet up right there. Some of that brown. There you go. That's kind of the color that I want. Now, really, what I'm seeing is, like I said on the other one, I had five different colors, like a black, yellow, and white. And this is kind of the same deal, but I can achieve that through just glazing. So I'll just do kind of like this one yellow, and then I'll do a second pass of it, and it'll make the darker yellows. And then I can use the same color and start to paint this hammer thing. The thing I want to avoid are all the white shapes. So I'm painting around those. And I guess I should use my smaller brush. So. Back to my small brush. Take some of that water off. Pick up some of that paint. And again, I'm trying to avoid the white shapes. So wherever those white shapes are, I'm gonna paint around them. I don't want to just paint this all over the black either, because that might loosen up the black and pollute the yellow that I'm laying down. This might be a bit too bright. But I think on first go around, I think it's okay. I'll just let that paint push a little bit. All right. Yeah, that's pretty good. All right. It's all good right there. It's good. Down here, that's yellow. Down there. Just around that one. So it extends down there. It's a white shape right there. The top side of that. But maybe there's just a little halo right there. Yeah, okay, cool. It's right there. Anything else? Maybe this little bit right there. So I'm just trying to be a bit meticulous. You can start to see it come together a bit. I think this here, that there, that's white. This is a little off, so that needs some. That's fine, that's fine, that's fine. Oh, actually, this is dark down here. Okay. We'll let that set for a second, but now what I want to do is take this down a little bit darker, where blue and red overlaid will get darker and darker and darker. Yellow overlaid just gets more and more yellow. It gets brighter and brighter. So what we need to do for this is actually change the color a little bit. And so to this, I'm going to add, you know, some violet because it's complementary. It doesn't take much. You can see I'm sort of like off the palette here, or off my color in the palette. And I'm just introducing that and picking up some of that paint, and I'm getting it to be more yellow. And I can use either or. I can sort of like scoop this up and start to introduce that over here. Maybe that's too much yellow, so I can kind of break it away from the rest of that. So now with this, I'm going to go for those like darker yellow color shapes. I'm just going to come in, and this is going to help add that much more dimension. It might need a second coat of this, but I should be able to get pretty close to what I want on this first pass. It's kind of dark over here. The darker something is, the further back it feels visually. So if it reads like it's too close, sometimes what that means is the overall value is too light. So if you make something a bit darker, it'll start to fall back in space. And so that's what I want to have happen kind of in some of these areas. So they start to feel further back than say the thing that's right in front of it. So like this one tentacle here should feel like it's more forward. Or like this area here should feel more forward than that like leg right behind it. And maybe this area here can go darker, so I'm going to do a second pass on that. Let me structure some of that eye. Get darker there. And truth be told, I mean, it's a confusing shape to begin with, but it's starting to take like form the way that it appears in the image. I think I could do one more darker pass. So maybe I pick up just a bit more violet like that. I need some water here. Just a bit more violet. That's a lot. And a lot of this yellow. And what you can start to see happen is now we're getting kind of into the family of this object. So that's kind of handy that we've sort of arrived where we are going to finish this up. I should wait a little bit, let this set up a little bit more. I can go for it, I think. I think it needs more violet than that. I think it needs to go darker. So less water, more intense paint. Even though that's really thin, I can let it sit on itself. Yeah, there you go. And then that thing. Right there. And so all I'm doing is just trying to get a little bit more form through that value. I feel like that's pretty good. I'm gonna switch out to my slightly bigger brush because I got more space to work in. This is a good start, but I want to, you know, I can sort of jumpstart that a little bit by dipping into my yellow ochre here. Yellow ochre is really just sort of a neutralized yellow. You can kind of see the difference here between this and this. It's like a brownish yellow, meaning that it has some of that violet that's in there, that's in this mix here. You can kind of see some similarities. But if I want to control that more, I can add more violet, kind of push that there. This yellow ochre maybe has a little bit of red in it. So maybe pick up some more yellow, push it a bit yellower. I'm just going to mix out here. That's pretty good. Yep. So that kind of gets me in the right family. And I'm going to do like a light coat because I can layer and do the darker areas as needed. So do this. I'm just going to kind of do the entire thing that's wood. So that's this little hammer. I'm a little oversaturated, but that's okay. I can just take some of that paint off my brush and then move that paint around. Go around is, it's like a sticker that's on there. A little bit more paint. I'm gonna try to avoid some of those halos where you kind of like have one, you're sort of brushing up against another color. So you end up not getting close enough. If it happens, it happens. I don't mind it too much in my own work, but I know that sometimes I've had students sort of point it out. So this game's kind of, I mean, it's a simple little toy. You just stack it all up with that hammer. It like sticks in, there's a hole in the middle. And then you use the hammer to knock the pieces out from under the head. And they go flying. Pulled up a little bit right there and right there. I'm just trying to control that a bit. All right. Because this is in that yellow family, if we try to do the shadow side with that same color, it's just gonna get more intense. So we need to adjust the color and make a darker version of it in order to get the shadow side of of this little toy thing. So for that, I'm just gonna add violet to this, more violet. It's a lot. Just just going to mix that on up. Something like that. And you can see, oh, can you see that? Can't really see that. I have this like small little swatch that I laid down of that color. I'm going to drag it in here. So here's the swatch of that color. And then here's that new shadow color that I just mixed. So I just tested it. Let that sit for a second. Pretty good. I'm going to come in. There's some verticality to the way the wood grain is going. I'm not overly concerned with that, but I am going to just paint it maybe in that direction. It's a little saturated, so I'm just going to break that up a bit. There's a highlight along that rim, so I can just kind of pick up that by leaving that untouched. Here, I'm not getting too much, so I don't want to. It's pretty close to that color, so I don't want to paint too heavy and too saturated in there. I got on his face, that's okay. There. His face is in shadow. I'm gonna have to figure out what that is here in a second. And then there's a little bit of a shadow here on the kind of underside of that barrel. And I'm going to use that like clean water trick where I just take all the paint off and I basically just have clean water to break that edge up just a little bit. It'll help sort of blend it out. And then the hammer head end, I'm just going to dip into some of this black that I mixed out. Because it is pretty dark, pick up some of this brown that I mixed like that, and then just come in here, give it a second, it's dry enough. I am getting a little bit of this like shadow right up in here. That's really fine. It's a bit wet, so I just should give it a little bit more time than this, but just enough to kind of indicate that there's that bit of shadow right there. Yeah. Last thing I have to do is I'm going to let it set for a second. I'm going to mix out a shadow for the sticker of the face. I use blue out here, so I could very well just use blue on that, like the same kind of like grayish blue here. I think that might work. Yeah, I think that'll work. I want to make sure that I don't like pollute. If it's wet, it'll like bleed in and then I'll lose a lot of that color. So I just want to give it some time to set properly. One of these blues is the right one. I think it's this guy right here. It's really pale, so I feel like that's fine. And it's just gonna kind of mimic what the rest of these shadows are doing. And so it's just sort of like here. And then I could do that like trick where I just take some clean water and just break up that edge, just soften that edge out with some clean water.
It became very three-dimensional just now, just with that little bit of adding.
Yeah. I mean, when you have, especially like black areas, it flattens it out. So you have to work really hard to kind of like redefine the dimension of that. I think that's zoom in right there. There you go. So I mean it's pretty close to done. Like I said, I could revisit this, but I mean there's a lot of form happening on that spray bottle. Even in its sort of simplified state. And then I don't want to go overly detailed with this because then it would kind of put everything else sort of out of whack, you know. Right now, I feel like the octopus, the spray bottle, the fan, everything has the same level of detail and attention and information to kind of make sense of what it is that you're seeing. It's good to, when you're painting, when you're making art, to walk away from your painting. Let your eyes reset, let your brain reset, and then come back and then reassess. When you're sort of in the middle of it, making it, it's hard to make overall judgment calls because it's like you can't see the forest for the trees. So you need to like get away, think about something else, go eat lunch or have a snack or whatever, and then come back. And then see where everything sits and see how you feel about it. And it could just be as simple as closing your eyes also. Just closing your eyes, not thinking about it, can help. I do think that the handles can get more yellow. They're getting a little bit lost with the rest of the fan. It's sort of relying on the pencil line. And I can push that yellow a little bit more intensely to just give it more shape. So I think I want to do that. I'll probably have to squeeze out some new yellow because like my yellows here are really dirty and I just messed up the one over here on this side, that guy. And that'll give me that intense yellow that I'm looking for. But aside from that, I think it's pretty much done. What do y'all think? It's okay? Yeah.
Looks good.
Thank you. You know, I was
beautiful.
Thank you. I'm really pleased with how the fan turned out. Like, I was really, truth be told, I was a little worried that it wasn't going to read correctly when I was painting it. I talked a little bit about that. But I think it turned out really nicely. And I feel like it looks like it has all those folds without having to paint it. Like, this is really exciting to me. Like the way that the print folds on itself.
Yeah, the fan is beautiful. The bottle water is nice, the green.
Yeah. Yeah, so let me grab some paint and squeeze out a little bit more yellow. Let me find a clean area. I have this other little palette here. I'm just gonna put up here.
So, Mark.
Yes.
I wanted to comment on this project. The fan looked so difficult from the beginning, and you made it look easy when you painted it. It came out beautifully, and the frog just turned me off. I'm like, why? I don't want to do this frog thing. But I love learning every single step of the way of how you are making this into that picture is phenomenal. And the octopus, I can't even believe it. It's, you did such a great job with that. Thank you.
Well, thank you. You know, it's a lot of times we have these hurdles that we kind of, we get frozen with, where we think like, oh, it's got to look like this thing. And like, this does not look like like an octopus. Like, it's crazy looking. And really, if you trust this idea that you're just painting shapes in the right place, like, it's going to look like what it's supposed to look like. And no matter what it is, if you're painting a person, if you're painting a weird frog or a fan, you know, just trusting this idea that, you know, you could place the right shape in the right color and it'll turn out all right. Yeah. And that's really, like, you know, sort of going back to Ryan asking, am I going to sort of teach more drawing observational techniques? And really, same thing is true for painting. Like, when I teach a painting class, like, we were kind of talking about this on day one. You know, we were doing monochromatic stuff, like with the understanding of the image, you're tracing that shape, but really forcing yourself to think about it in terms of less of object and more about what it is that you're actually seeing. That's sort of the entirety of this class from start to finish. Like, I've again given all of the instruction, and it's just like small changes here and there. So now we're in color, so it's a little bit more complex, but still the same thing. All right, so just loosen up this yellow. I don't want it chunky. I just want it nice and intense and really vibrant. Now, there is some discrepancy between, say, the actual image and the painting. And I mean, that's true for the majority of painting, unless you're so meticulous that you're like a photorealist painter. You know, painting is its own thing. It's like similar but different. So this looks similar, but it might be a little different. That's okay. All right, so now I'm just going to try to, it's not enough. Just try to like build up that overall shape. Clean it up a little bit. That's good. Usually, so I projected this image when I transferred it, and sometimes I'm a little clumsy with how much I'm actually transferring. So you can see that line doesn't go perfectly straight across the way that it should. Like, this is a little misshapen here. There is some value that's happening here, but I don't know that it's significant enough for me to create. So I'm just going to paint this in the way that I think it's going to work, and then I'll reassess. And if I need to bring that dark value in here, then I can always do that. But I do think that this might be enough. And I think it is. So that little bit sort of separates the handle from the rest of the fan just by shifting that level of intensity. Yeah, I think I'll call this one done. Yeah. You know, it's one of those things also where you could be sort of infinitely fussy, and a lot of people are. I try to not be. And it's not necessarily out of laziness, although that does kind of play a role. Like sometimes your brain gets exhausted. Like, you know, I've been working on this thing, not very long by any means, but probably like 4 hours, right? So like two and two. And for me, that seems like a long time. So I feel like I've invested a lot of like brain power to it. And I don't know that I can invest more. And sometimes that happens. Sometimes you have like more bandwidth to expend on your painting. I like to kind of let things sort of resolve themselves visually. I like to let it fall apart sometimes visually. So I'm not overly meticulous, and that's more of like a style preference, I guess. And so you have to kind of find what's comfortable for you. So some of you might be like, you could go further. You can fix this. You can fix that. And I'm sure I could. And you could do that forever and ever and ever. And that's why sometimes you'll see like paintings in a museum that go from like the date that it was made was like 1730 till 1756. And it's like, man, this person worked on the painting for like 20 years. Like, that's crazy. But they didn't have TV or anything else, so it was a little bit easier and probably more fun back then. So yeah,
I think a lot of artists also have more than one thing going at a time, so
yeah,
sometimes yeah. That'll result in things taking years to be done.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, that's definitely true. Like when I'm painting, I generally have two or three paintings like all at once, and you know, because while you're waiting for paint to dry, you just work on something else. So that's definitely true, but it's also good to know when to stop. And that's right. Also sometimes
right, because sometimes if you keep working it, then you ruin it.
You know, yeah. Over and over. That's yeah. True. Yeah.
Overwork it. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you know, the more experience you have, the more exposure you have to other art and looking at other people's art, it's going to open up the possibility of like how little can you do or how much can you do. I tend to be on the very like how little can I do. And just recently I did these paintings where I was like, I want to push myself. I want to like really try to paint as intensely as I could ever paint. And they turned out really well, but it's like my hat's off to people that work that way, because it is a whole other thing that I'm not ready for. I think this is a good place to stop. Any questions, any comments, concerns?
It's really pretty. I love thank you.
I have a question.
Yes.
It seems like a lot of folks in this class are already artists in some way or another, and I'm just wanting to know, hey, how do I tap into a creative side that I haven't tried yet? How did you know that you were an artist? At what point did you know, hey, this is what I want to do?
That's a good question. I guess go to the screen. How did I know I wanted to be an artist? Yeah. I think my mom would still argue like I should go get a better job. You know, I kind of grew up drawing and, you know, just sort of superheroes. I was into comic books, and I actually started school to go into math and science, and I kind of thought to myself, like, I don't want to do math for the rest of my life. Like, I'd much rather paint. I'd much rather sort of be creative. And luckily enough, I was able to kind of like learn and expose myself to this larger world. So college is kind of maybe the time that I realized, like, oh, I could do this. Like, this is a real thing that could actually happen. And it wasn't even like the beginning of college. It was more towards like, as I was getting closer to graduating. So like my junior or sophomore year, I spent a long time at community college, basically spinning my wheels, thinking like, if I was going to be an artist, I'm going to like paint like figures and sell them on like cruise ships and stuff. Which, I mean, that's totally fine. If you can make that work, that's great. But going to see contemporary artists, people that are maybe just a few years older than me, or, you know, was really inspiring to see that, like, oh, they can, that they did it, or they're doing it, and so can I. It doesn't feel too out of reach. But I think the biggest issue was to like tap into sort of that level of creativity was to really be willing to kind of risk what I thought was good, like to explore what creativity actually means. Creativity to me isn't about making a pretty picture the way that I've been sort of taught a pretty picture is, you know. Creativity is really starting to define what are my aesthetics, what are the principles and ideas and visuals that I want to see in the world, you know. And it's really only through like risking failure, basically, you know, like being willing to kind of make a painting and have it all sort of just totally implode on itself, because I don't want to be safe. I don't want to make that pretty picture that my mom kind of complains, like, I have all my paintings from like undergrad in her house still, and she does not like any of them. She does not get any of them. She's like, what are these paintings about? Like, can you just paint like my grandkids or my house or, you know, flowers? And so like that to me felt safe. And so I didn't want to just like make paintings for other people. I wanted to make paintings that were challenging to me, that were interesting to me. And that's sort of where I tapped into that creativity, was being willing to risk the safety of what the status quo of what people want is. So, yeah. But then eventually I just painted like this flower painting for my mom, and now my wife and her are like arguing over whose house it goes into. So.
Have you done any shows? Have you had any of your own shows?
Yeah, so I try to have a show, or I'm in a group show every year. Nothing yet, but I was just recently at a show in Southwest College in Oceanside, and then also a show in Laverne. And that was just last year, but I'm usually in a show.
Oceanside. We're in Oceanside.
It was at Southwestern College in the gallery.
That's Chula Vista.
Chula Vista. Yeah,
it's not Oceanside because I wasn't from. I live in Oceanside, so
I was getting confused. Yeah, yeah, Chula Vista, and I'm currently in a show at Chaffey College in Rancho Cucamonga. I show constantly. I do have a website, so if you want to see my paintings, you're more than welcome to check it out. It's marklb.com.
I think I have your stuff.
I can just type it in here, and I think it's pretty current. I don't have maybe my newest stuff, but it's pretty up to date, up to 2022, I think.
So do you do primarily watercolor, or do you do other media?
Mainly I'm an acrylic painter. Yeah, But the way that I paint with acrylics is very thin and watery. So there's a lot of like analog between the two. So yeah, like I'm not necessarily a watercolor painter, but I feel confident enough with watercolor. But yeah, acrylic paint, I do photos, I do video, I do sculpture, I do drawings, kind of everything and anything. And yeah.
Any type of art.
Pretty much. And then I teach digital art. So I'm really proficient Photoshop and Illustrator and After Effects. So yeah.
I couldn't get past the layers. I tried to do. I just couldn't get layers. I just didn't understand it.
It's hard to manage all those things. Yeah.
One last question. Back to the floral print that you did for your mother, and now your wife and she are fighting over who gets it. Are we going to do any floral? Or what do we have to look forward to into what we're going to be painting next?
I have to look at the schedule, but I can just give you maybe like a tour of sort of previous work, and you can kind of sort of gauge where we're at. So let me switch to that. I just have like a ton of paintings here. Kind of clear some stuff out, figure out which way is up.
I really like your use of canvas. You're the first instructor that I've had that has used it, and I find it very helpful.
Well, good. I think that it's a great resource. It's all sort of like located in one uniform place. You don't have to go like searching for it. And it's great because you have access to it and you can go through it at your own pace. So I think that's really important. All right. So some of it is from intermediate painting. So, you know, you can kind of, this one is from intermediate painting, but it's, you know, a lot of still life stuff. This was from our class. That's from intermediate. It was intermediate as well. And it's that one. We'll do some work based on photos. We'll do some experimental things with like wet into wet and like letting the paint bloom and kind of controlling that.
I like wet into wet.
I think this was towards the end of beginning painting, beginning watercolor.
It's just
like, instead of like finding typical things of beauty, you know, like a portrait or whatever, you know, looking at really common everyday things and trying to find the beauty in that. So thinking less about like painting techniques and more about like subject matter. That's my house. This is a drawing. That's a disco ball. So the bagel, something very kind of common, very simple, but elegant in its like singleness. That's the inside. I do a portrait, so we do some portraits in here. Talk a little bit about that. Again, using some different imagery, trying to find opportunities for like color and what have you. Some more experimental things. So this is like a different painting technique, using a little bit wilder colors. Painting animals, so working from source imagery. Animals. That's a This way? This way. It's this way. This is my wife. She's also an artist. This way, I guess. doing sort of abstracted design, not necessarily like painting an actual subject. And then speaking of like flowers and stuff, this is like one of my favorite assignments, and it involves drawing with a pen, and we make like bouquets using rope and plants from just wherever, and then being really intricate about the drawing, and what's all that, and then going back in and painting once we have a line drawing. And I think I have a line drawing here as well. So this is the same assignment. You can kind of see, you know, all of the detail that you're getting with like the line work with a pen. Same assignment. Similar, this was just a drawing, but this is kind of the thing.
What kind of pen is that you're using? That one that you just showed.
For this one?
Yes.
Or this one. Okay. For this one, I'm using a brush pen, and it's generally something like this. This is the Tombow brush pen, and it's got a small little brush on the end, and you can get thicker lines and thinner lines. I don't know if you can see that. For like this one, this is done using like a Micron. This is what we call a technical pen. They're both technical pens, and they come in a variety of sizes. Like Micron makes brush pens as well. Different brands make different technical pens. So this one's an O2. I have like
so the Tombow, like, is that water resistant or
yes. You know?
Yeah. It's permanent? Okay.
Yeah. So this Micron, this is like an O2, so you can see the nib is really thin. And then I have like this is a 10. So the nib is considerably thicker. That's the point on the pen. And then I have like, this is a brush. And so it's all the same brand. And you can see that it's a brush like that. And you can get like thin lines and thick lines like you would with a brush. So we'll be doing that. This is kind of like the drawing version of that before we paint it. Actually, I have like prints of it. That's just some loose painting, more loose painting. This is experimenting with some different techniques, like resist and wet into wet. This was experimenting with etching and resist. So like the white areas, I laid down like rubber cement. And then I actually drew with a crayon because wax resists water. So you can draw with crayons and then the watercolor won't sit on it. You can see that. I scratched into it with a razor blade. So you get these like dark veins in there. This is a geometric abstraction. So we're like looking at hard edge painting, where all of the edges and shapes have very deliberate edges to them. No blending really. So we work on like, you have like an option of doing like a gemstone. You can kind of invent your own, or just do like an all over pattern. You know, so these two are in the same vein. So it's like you could do one or the other or both. This one's by my wife. It's an assignment. This one's also by my wife. So rather than them being sort of like cut gems, this is like loose rocks. Same. And then that's the monochromatic painting from like the beginning. Yeah. yeah, so that's kind of like what we cover in the class. And yeah, hope that answers your question. So we will get to some fun things.
Thank you, Mark.
Sure. Okay, so on that note, we will kind of end things here. Next week, we'll have an entirely new project. I don't know what it is yet. I had to just take a look at Canvas, but it'll be up and available for you to read up on and take a look at on Sunday. So you can see that. And then I think it's the animals. I think we're doing animal stuff. So working from like source images and painting an animal. So yeah.
Sounds good.
Yeah, I think, I'm pretty sure. That's why we did the grid transfer. That was like sort of like, I try to make it segue. Okay, so, yes.
Yes, I think you got color wheel. It wasn't too fun. I think you make a comment that I was a little confused, but now I'm reading it three times. Your comments, and I think I understand what it was about the if your complementary neutrons start to go between orange or violet, then there is too much blue, yellow, red, and the secondary colors. And I didn't understand at the beginning, like yellow versus green, too much blue in the violet.
Correct. And yeah.
I said violet, but then I just realized what you were trying to tell me.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it makes more sense the more that you the more that you experiment with the paint, the more that you make new colors, you'll start to realize I'm like if I'm mixing complementary colors, I'm really only mixing red, blue, and yellow together in different ratios.
Right.
So that's all that comment really meant. So
but now that I read it over and I realized that what you were trying to tell me.
yeah. Okay, all right, everyone, have a great week. I'll see you next Tuesday. Keep painting. Bye.
We will. Thank you.
Bye. Have a great day. Every day.
You too.
Thank you.